We're going to go to Sunday school this morning, all right? And usually in Sunday school, we start by singing a song, and I'd like for us to sing the song together. Here's a verse so you know the tune, okay? Hear it through once. Okay, we're going to Sunday school.
Oh, be careful, little eyes, what you see. Oh, be careful, little Good. Eyes, what you see.
Okay, everyone stand.
For the Father up above is looking down and
we're
loves.
Going to talk a little
so
bit about now about the
year.
Now, let's all sing. Let's join in the singing, okay? Now, hand, oh, tongue.
Be careful, little tongue, what you say. Be careful, little tongue, what you say. For the Father up above is looking down in love. So be careful, little tongue, what you say.
Okay, men only, but the hands now, okay? Men?
Be careful, little hands, what you do.
Come on, guys.
Be careful, little hands, what you do. For the Father up above.
Ladies, feet, shoes. Okay. Oh, my. I advanced it. Sit down. Sit down. Oh, my. I worked so hard so I could figure that out, and I just lost it. As a child, I remember singing that song in Sunday school. And my mother was a Sunday school teacher, so I had to pay attention to the song. And as we would sing, be careful, little tongue, what you say, we would point to our tongue. Or be careful, little feet, where you go, we'd point to our feet. And I hated that song. And the reason I hated the song, it seemed to be really negative. Be careful, be careful. Be careful. Big brother God is looking over me. And I got to thinking as I grew up a little bit that maybe there is another way of understanding that song that many of us grew up in Sunday school singing. And it's actually changing the stanzas of the song to questions. And we could understand a little better by turning them into questions, and that's what I would like to walk through this morning in this song we learn in Sunday school and finding some ways that I think can be extremely insightful on the teachings of Jesus in these areas of our lives. And so the first question is this, and it has to do with, does my heart care about what God's heart cares about? See, be careful, little heart, be careful, little heart. We didn't sing all the verses. But does my heart care about that? I've heard people say that they have prayed for a lot of things and many things that just never would come to pass. They would pray for a certain opportunity and it just flew by them. Or they would pray about a relationship or a job. But you know what? I've never heard anyone pray for. I've never heard a person say, I want to pray urgently, persistently, day after day, that I would have a heart like the kind of heart that Jesus had for people. What an interesting and intriguing prayer request. Because obviously there was something about this heart of our Lord, this passion of our Lord, that would reach out. I think God would answer that prayer if we would ask for that, that we would have a heart like Jesus. And then there's another one, be careful, little feet, where you go, all right? And here's the question, do my feet take me where Jesus' feet took him? Let's explore a moment where Jesus' feet took him. They took him to people who were really far from God. They took him where the Pharisees' feet would never take the Pharisees. They took him to parties at tax collectors' houses. His feet took him to dinners that were attended by prostitutes. His feet, they took him to the country of Samaria, where in his day any respectable religious person would never go to where those Samaritans are. His feet took him to lepers. Lepers where no one else would ever go. His feet took him to every kind of persons. And you know what? His feet got him in a lot of trouble. Think about it. There's an expression that's often throughout the scriptures used to refer to Jesus, and they call him the friend of sinners. You've heard that, right? It's in the Bible. And we tend to think of that, oh, Jesus is the friend of sinners, as some kind of compliment. But when we read in the Bible that he was a friend of sinners, that was not intended as a way to be something complimentary, but it was a title of insult and of hostility. Friend of sinners, Jesus was with them. Jesus loved them. And the Pharisees hated him because of that. They just simply did not understand his feet, but God loved his feet. And there is that wonderful verse in Isaiah where it talks about the feet. And it says here, how beautiful on the mountains are the feet of those who bring good news and proclaim to Zion, your God reigns. How beautiful are the feet of those who come with the gospel. And if you think about it, Jesus' feet, they were so beautiful to people far from God that one day there was a woman who thought that she was lost beyond hope, and she gave her greatest treasure by anointing the feet of Jesus. And she bathed them with her tears. And she dried them with her hair. And because of those feet, they brought Jesus to her. And she was overwhelmed and amazed. And you and I think we can have those kind of feet as well. They could take you to people who are far from God. Well, there's another song that maybe we pass up as we try to sing it. Be careful, little hands, what you do. You know, the hands, what's my hand doing? And so the question is, as we try to apply that song today, and that is, do my hands, do they do what Jesus' hands did? What do we glean from scriptures of what Jesus did with his hands? Jesus' hands, they were extended to service to other people. In Matthew's gospel, there is a wonderful story of a leper who approaches Jesus. And the man asked, the leper asked, that he could be made clean. Now, the law of Jesus' day was very strict about lepers. You couldn't have any contact with a non-leper. They had to cry out. If they saw someone coming by, they would have to cry out, unclean, unclean, stay away from me. Don't get around me. They had to stay outside the village. You talk about living in isolation. Nobody would come within 10 feet of a leper. But this leper, as we read the scripture, comes to Jesus. And he says, will you make me clean? What a question. What a story. And what's interesting, Jesus doesn't turn away. Jesus, he reaches out his hand and he touches the man who had not been touched for who knows how many years. Jesus didn't have to do that. He's the King of Kings and Lord of Lords. He could have just said the word and it would have been done. But no, he wanted to reach out and touch the man, touch the leper. And what did he say? Be clean. Be clean. And as we read the scriptures, we find that Jesus kept extending his hand, healing lepers, touching children, washing feet, grasping his hands in prayer. And then all of a sudden, not only were those hands in prayer, but it was those very hands that took a nail on the cross. For the sake of all who have ever lived, look at what he did with his hand. So, in worship this Sunday morning, look at your hand. Consider your hands. How often is your hand extended as Jesus' was in service to others? Maybe you have a neighbor that needs some help mowing their lawn. Or heaven forbid, before you know it, we're going to be shoveling snow. And you could extend a hand and someone you know would be blessed by shoveling snow. And by the way, we need more volunteers to remove snow here this winter. Thought I would get that in. Or to do errands. Or maybe there's somebody at work or at school. And they're discouraged. And you could use your hand to write a note that would honor God to encourage them. They will know where that comes from. They will know the values that led to writing it. And that is a marvelous witness of using the hands like Jesus did. So I'll ask you, how about your hands? Your hands. Will you extend them to the service of others? And we have marvelous illustrations of that in our church. I think of our Stephen ministers. They're persons who had an enormous amount of training and to equip themselves to do one thing, to extend a caring hand of service to someone who desperately needs that kind of care. And of course, the service team, they're always leading us in ways to where we can care and extend a hand. Well, there's also my mouth. Oh, there's a lot in the scripture about the mouth and the role of the tongue. And so the question is, does my mouth say what Jesus' mouth would say? So look at that subject. What did Jesus say? What is the primary words from Jesus? Okay? And I'm saying primary words. What do you see as you read the New Testament, especially the Gospels, where you see the dominant phrases that Jesus uses, which is a clue. This is an insight as to what Jesus was about. It's not some weird remote statement that someone made that you base some kind of crazy doctrine on. It's what do you see in the mainstream of Jesus' teaching? What did he say? Well, there is a common theme. You go to Luke, and you find this. Jesus said to the woman, "Your faith has saved you. Go in peace." Then elsewhere in Luke, Jesus himself stood among them and said to them, "Hey, peace be with you." And then we can go to John's gospel, and Jesus said, "Peace be with you. As the Father has sent me, I am sending you." And then right after the crucifixion and then the resurrection of Jesus in John's gospel, the 20th chapter, Jesus is with the disciples who were in the house again, and Thomas was with them. And though the doors were locked, Jesus came and stood among them, and he said, that phrase again, "Peace be with you." So there's some dynamic when Jesus was present that the words he would speak would be words of peace in the midst of the chaos of life. We have a September 11 memorial provided at our sanctuary this morning by Sue Freedy and Marie Gray. Thank you so much for doing that, so that we could remember that event and recognize it. And I'll never forget that fateful morning when it happened. And it was just 3 months after this church had its first worship service. We were a new church getting started, and then this happens. I received a phone call from Wisconsin Memorial Park. I knew their management well, and they said, "Lonnie, this is obviously a tragic happening September 11. Could you come and use our chapel to lead a community service, prayer service for 911? I said, "Absolutely." And then we gathered and had that event, which a date I'll never forget, because it was a time we really wondered what would come of peace. At that time, we were meeting in homes, in small groups, and after the service, the day that 911 happened, we were back in homes and just together and have prayer. It's all we knew to do. And I never will forget that night. I went to the home of a group that met at Paige Slotke's home. Paige is watching us online in Florida, where she lives now. Never forget it. She has two dogs, big and little. Little is buried here on the campus. We have a lot of animals throughout the woods. And as we were concluding our prayer service, holding our hands in a circle, we prayed, and then we would sing, "God Bless America." And I never will forget, as we were singing it, Little Big started howling and singing along with us. And it was just a moment where it just was a pause to realize that when Jesus said, "Peace is with you," peace is already here. It is. It just has to be realized. It's not going to come when some negotiators figure it out. That might help you a little bit. But the peace that never ends, the peace that the scriptures talks about that is beyond human comprehension, is this peace that was in the words of Jesus as he spoke. And he said, "Peace be among you." And he said that to persons who have experienced their own kind of 911. Okay, I've got a heart. I want to have feet like Jesus. I want to do what his hands are doing. I want to have a mouth that speaks about the at-handness of God's kingdom and the peace that it brings. There is one last thing that I think I need to have to be like Jesus. And it wasn't in the song. It was missing in that song. And I think a lot of us need it as well. Here's what I also need from Jesus. I need his spine. I need his backbone to carry on, because it's not easy doing this thing we do. The Apostle Paul would talk about the foolishness of the gospel. You get out of your comfortable bed on Sunday morning, and you have this discipline of meeting with others to pray to a God you can't see? Think about that. A spine. In one of the stories that Jesus told, he was speaking about the growth of the kingdom of God. And he said that it's like a sower who comes out and sows seed. And as the sower sows seed, some of it falls on ground, Some of it falls on the path. Some of it gets eaten up by birds. Some of it falls on shallow soil where there's no rock underneath it and nothing much happens. But they just keep on sowing and sowing. Some of it may fall on cluttered soil and it tries to grow, but it just gets choked up. And you would think by this time, after Jesus talks about all these failed efforts of the sower that he would quit, just when you think he's about to give up, sooner or later, some of it falls on good soil. Sooner or later, it falls on good soil. And then what happens? Jesus says, watch out. Watch out. Watch out. You don't quit sowing seed because maybe the next one is the one that will take root. We need his spine persistently never to give up. Believe in these values that our Lord died for, what he provided on the cross. And I think seed has fallen here on really good soil. It has. It is. Continue to cultivate it. We need to press on and nurture this garden of the soul. We need Jesus' heart, we need his feet, we need his hands, we need his mouth, and we need his spine. And may ours be his. Amen. Please stand in our concluding hymn. As we're grateful for the peace of God that is at hand, that is among us, Jesus, if he was going to say a word here, he would say, peace be among you. 911, peace be among you. Greater is he who is in you than he who is in the world, the scripture says. Let us be children as we walk as children of the light.